you.
It's been a little while.
Yeah.
Well,
everything will be
actually,
in this
room. I came to the board meeting.
Oh, yes, you're at the board meeting. Yeah.
I think we like, oh, I kept my distance. I don't know what's over there. And then you guys stayed hung around afterwards. So, all good.
Let me get my name tag.
Yep, Kathy Brister.
Hi, Nydia.
Good morning, Kathy.
How are you?
I'm doing very well.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to tell me your name again.
Dana.
Dana, we met. You were at Welcome, right? Did you work
on her? I have in the past.
I don't think she did this last year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't think so.
You look familiar. I think we've met at some point.
I'm sure that you have.
Oh, the accelerator.
Yeah.
Good morning. My name is Richard Griffiths. I'm a Georgia First Amendment Foundation board member. And I'd like to welcome everybody to the 32nd Bar, Media, and Judiciary Conference. It's the third year that the conference is presented with the organizational support of the foundation. This conference was originally conceived by some judges and journalists as a way to get real conversations going between those justices and journalists and lawyers that don't always see eye to eye. The goal was to help all three groups better understand the others, their motivations, and also the political, judicial, and legal challenges they face and the state of Georgia faces. We have a really terrific program for the day. For the full rundown, you can go to the QR code or type in the bit.ly and get the rundown. You can get the bios, and you can get the additional supplemental materials, which there's quite a bit. We will have a working lunch today, and we'll let you know when those box lunches are in, so you can go get yours before all of the vegetarian ones or the ones with extra mustard disappear. I also want to remind everybody that there will be a reception at the end of the day, a good opportunity for some networking, good opportunity to meet the organizers and tell us what we should do better for next year, and your fellow participants. My big job today is going to try to keep the trains running on time and trying to make sure we are keeping somewhat close to the schedule, particularly around lunchtime. We've got a taping with WABE, and so we need to be really precise about that time. And so if we ask you to get back to your seats, please get back to your seats. Now I want to talk about the sponsors whose contributions go so far as to support this conference. The names are now on the screen: the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, CNN, big sponsor, the State Bar of Georgia, which gives us enormous support in setting up this conference, and the space, and your parking. So thanks very much to the State Bar and to Jones Day. And you see the other many generous sponsors on that list. This conference would not have been pulled together if it was not for the tireless work of the volunteers that you see on the screen. It's a lot of volunteers. A lot of hard work goes into this conference. I want to especially thank Peter Canfield from Jones Day, who patiently guides this committee through the preparation of this event. Now we'll turn to the kickoff panel of the conference.
Reception and a glass of wine, so we're going to get going here. In the interest of getting going as fast as we can, I know that Governor Deal just sat down, and I don't think he needs a long introduction, so I'm going to ask him to come back up. He's going to talk for a while, Governor Deal, and on a topic that he is passionate about and certainly has accomplished a lot about. So without further ado, Governor Nathan Deal.
Thank you very much, Kevin.
thanks to all of you for being here today, and there's nothing much worse than a has-been, and I feel in that category, I'm afraid. But I want to thank, first of all, I want to thank Carey Miller for inviting me and for what he and Chief Justice Michael Boggs have done with regard to the criminal justice issues, and they have done great work. And if you really want an expert, you just need to ask the Chief Justice of our Supreme Court. He's the one who really was the leader in the reform over the eight years, considering the first year when we organized the Criminal Justice Reform Council. Let me try to be as brief as I can. You probably have heard enough statistics, but I want to give you just a little bit of a feel for why criminal justice reform actually was undertaken in 2011. At that time, we had a population in our prison system of about 56,000, and it had doubled between 1990 and 2011. The prison population had doubled, and it had in fact increased 35% between 2000 and 2011. 35% increase in that relatively short period of time. We had the fourth highest rate of adults in prison of any state in the country, and we were only the eighth largest population, but the fourth largest prison population at that time. Our prisons were overcrowded at about 107% capacity, and as a result of that, even though we were spending $1.1 billion to the Department of Corrections, we still had that overcapacity. Now, one of the things that is amazing that you can really understand quickly is that when I was on the campaign trail in 2010 and I would talk to sheriffs, the first thing they would say is, when are you going to get all these state prisoners out of my local jail? Because in that year, we were paying some $25 million to local sheriffs to keep prisoners who had already gotten sentenced to a state sentence, but to keep them in their local jail because we didn't have room for them in our prisons. We were told we're going to have to build two new adult prisons within the first 4 years, that first term that I had, and things didn't look particularly well. Now, there are a lot of talking points that were used by me and perhaps a few of the others here on this platform today as we were trying to convince the public that this effort to reform our prison system or our criminal justice system was important. One that I used and always got some heads turning, and that is that one out of every 13 Georgians was under some form of correctional supervision. Now, if you go to the local Kiwanis Club or the Rotary Club and you say that, and they're a little bit shocked when they hear it, and the next reaction they have is they start looking around the room trying to figure out who is that one out of 13 that's sitting close to me. One of the reasons we had such a high population that was in that category of being under some kind of supervision was that we had an excessively large number of people who were given probation. They may have probation on the front end, but they also may have probation on the tail end after they have served whatever criminal sentence they had been sentenced to by the judge, but they had probation tacked on the end of it. And that really was one of the primary things, I think, that caused us to have such a high percentage of people in that category of being under some kind of supervision. Well, today, and I know the General Assembly being in session and the governor and others have talked about the problem of criminal justice issues that are facing our state today. We have certainly, and I understand the reasons, and I am sympathetic and hope that the General Assembly will devise some answers that will be satisfying to the public and will help solve the problem that we're facing today. But I want you to understand the distinction. As much as some would try to say that what we did is now being undone by the General Assembly and by the governor today. That is totally incorrect. We were concentrating our efforts on those that we classified as nonviolent of individuals. And 25% of those who were going into our prison system were being classified as nonviolent, and yet they're going to a prison bed. That was cumulative on top of what had happened for several decades as the approach had been to get tough on crime. Longer sentences, mandatory minimums, and we had this huge amount of those who were in our prison system that were classified as nonviolent. Now you try to explain to the average voter why you're spending $20,000 to keep somebody that you say is classified as nonviolent in a prison bed. Didn't make a whole lot of sense. So after Barry, Margaret, and I and others sort of softened them up a little bit with those kind of rather staggering statistics, it made it easier to pass criminal justice reform. In fact, when I first announced it, that was an agenda item for my administration, I was told, you're a Republican. That doesn't sound like a Republican issue. Why are you doing it? I said, because it's the right thing to do. But with that mindset of the political separation as to where this issue stood, it was amazing with the work of members of the General Assembly and those of you, some of you in this audience were supportive of that and helping us to convince people that it was the right thing to do. The first year, we tackled adults who were nonviolent, and it meant really expanding the accountability court system, which was really very small at that time. I think we had only 33 drug courts in the entire state of Georgia at that time. And now I'm pleased to say we have accountability courts in every one of our judicial circuits, and I think there are 49 different judicial circuits. And they are of multiple types of courts. We started out with the drug courts, the DUI courts. They've expanded veterans courts, family courts, and more importantly now, I think, mental health courts. And that's, of course, the gist of what is going to be the focus of this panel discussion here today. And it's altogether appropriate that we do so. Now, what they're focusing on now, and I'm going to hit it quickly because I'm not an expert on this and not in a position to do anything about it. They're focusing on things like gang activity. And certainly I think all of us are concerned with that. We don't want to see any more young people siphoned off into gangs and therefore in as being fodder for our prison system. They are focusing on the prosecution. We've had several DAs, I understand, in our state who publicly announced that they're not going to prosecute people for certain offenses in their particular circuit. Well, I understand that one of the ways they're going to propose to do that is to lower the percentage of the population that has to sign on to a recall petition. And as a former county attorney who went through a recall petition on my county commissioners, every one of them got recalled. It was not an easy task to even get that proposition before the public, but once it gets some steam behind it, it can really take off and go. But the threshold is being proposed to be lowered, and I think that is probably a very appropriate way of trying to resolve that problem. Before I get into a few other minor issues that I want to touch on, I want to congratulate you on the panel that you have here. You have one of the senior members of the state house and longtime friend of mine. She used to practice law in Gainesville, Georgia. In my circuit, you were a public defender at that time, or the equivalent of a public defender. I've known Mary Margaret for many, many years, and both of us have the white hair to prove it. So, but she's an expert, and I'm pleased to see her on the panel. And of course, the others will speak for themselves. My friend, the senator, and of course, the probably one of the most outstanding accountability court judges that we have here, Carey Miller, as I've already referenced, who was my legal counsel for part of the years that we were undertaking these legislative reforms. And then Kevin Tapp, the new commissioner of the Department of DBHDD. And I first met Kevin when he was a deputy sheriff in Dawson County. And he is extremely well qualified for the position to which he's been appointed. And I think we're all gonna see that he's got proposals in his department that are gonna make a huge difference in dealing with these issues of mental problems. So, and it's certainly one that I think deserves to be addressed. But like anything, when you start either going in a new direction or expanding the direction you may have already started, in government, it takes resources, it takes personnel, it takes money to provide the kind of resources that are needed. And in the mental health arena, one of the things that we need is we need more doctors, more psychiatrists who are trained to deal with these very specific type of issues. We need more nurses to work with them. We need a lot of support personnel because it is a more intense, hands-on kind of problem that you'll be dealing with. Now, once again, I recall from the campaign days, when you talk to a sheriff, they would bring up the subject of mental health issues, even back some 12 years ago or so. And what they would say is, everybody in my jail has a mental health issue. And quite frankly, they were probably right. We had not given enough insight and thought as to what that really meant, because the types of mental issues that they had were varied, to say the least. Now, one of the areas I referred to earlier was in the accountability courts is the expansion of the mental health courts. And I think many of your circuits probably already have those courts in place, and they are doing an exceptional job. Like all accountability courts, they are intended to deal with specific, defined categories of offenders based on what their particular needs are. Veterans courts, obviously the name implies what that population group is. One of the good things about that one is that if they're veterans, they can tap into the VA healthcare system, and they have a lot more resources sometimes than we can provide at the state level, and those courts, I'm sure, are doing that. Now, my daughter drove me down today, and I am still shell-shocked from all the traffic that we had to go through coming down from Habersham County just to get here on time today. And the little GPS, it kept saying, well, it started out, we're gonna get here at 3:24. Then it got to be 3:48. Then it got to be 4:01, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, reminded me of why I don't come here very often. This is the third time this week I've had to come down to Atlanta. So anyway, she told me, said, I told her what I was gonna use as an analogy for you today. And she said, be careful how far you get with that analogy. So I love analogies because I think they're the way that you can talk about something without talking about it, because you can analogize similar situations. So I'm gonna give one that, Kevin, you've never heard this one before, I am sure. Have any of you, and I'm gonna ask for participation, show of hands, have any of you ever developed a piece of property, whether it be for your home, that required that you had to grade the lot off? Okay. Have any of you ever developed a piece of property for an office building or even like a subdivision where you had to have the property graded off? I've done the office building. Okay. Well, now, there are certain things you have to do if you start disturbing that land. One of the things you have to do is you have to have silt fences up so that water does not push the dirt to places that it doesn't want to be. You don't want it to be. This is an environmental issue by all definitions. And in addition to silt fences, if you've got a big enough graded off spot, you're going to have a holding pond, a collection pond. Water will flow down. Hopefully the silt fences are going to catch the silt and the dirt and the water flows through this fabric that the silt fence is made of, and it proceeds on down, and then it collects into a holding pond. Now, my analogy is this. Those holding ponds are like our prisons. The silt fences are like our accountability courts. They're designed to try to keep the particles and the things that you don't want to fill up your prison system, and to try to keep them back and keep them in the general vicinity of where they are. My analogy appropriate?
Yes.
I think it may be. Now, I always worry about using analogies because I figure somebody in this group is going to say, oh, he's comparing people who get in trouble as dirt. No, I'm not doing that. And if you want to dispel your mind of that analogy, just remember the main thing that silt fences catch is the topsoil. Topsoil is the richest soil there generally is. So, what is happening in our criminal justice system sometimes is that we catch up some of the ones who really can be redeemed and can become very functioning members of our society. And that's why those courts are so critical, in my opinion, to meaningful and lasting criminal justice reform. So, not only did we not have to build those two new adult prisons, we actually saw our prison populations decline. And that was a very good thing. I'm not going to go into all of those statistics, but I can tell you that it saved our state a lot of money. It made things that were not thought of before available as we gave local judges and local counties the ability to use their imagination as to what suited their particular situation, and hopefully to keep and retain those citizens who otherwise might have wound up in that retention pond. Thank you very much for having me today. I appreciate the opportunity to be with you.
Thank you, Governor Deal, and thanks for the telling the story of really a brave initiative taken on by Governor of Georgia. So thank you for that. All right, well, what we're going to do next to get our panel going is Richard is going to queue up a video for us, I think. And I have great confidence that it will play because I had nothing to do with setting it up, but it's going to play.
11 years ago, I was in jail on the 9th floor in the Dade County Jail. I'm laying in a pile of feces, vomit, and urine. I'm sick, I'm hearing voices, I'm seeing things. They're like, oh, we'll put you on the psych floor. Thank goodness. Some people that understand me. I get up there, it's way worse, man.
Last year, about 1.5 million people with serious mental illnesses were arrested.
Our jails have become the largest public psychiatric institutions in the country.
We were spending $80 million a year to warehouse people in conditions that you wouldn't let your dog stay in. We know how to fix it. It's a question of political will and leadership. It's foolhardy what we do now, and it's cruel because we're not affording people the opportunity for recovery. We have this amazing program with amazing people that can help keep you out of here. I like to do that.
I always had
a normal
life. And I had this whole schizophrenia thing. I didn't know what was going on. This was such a psychological warfare.
He was really 5 years minimum. They just needed to diagnose him. And this kid has a totally different life.
Oh man, my ankle feels light.
I'm in recovery. Drugs, alcohol, mental health. You know, I've said stuff to people. They'll go before the judge.
And this boy crazier than me. Why am I listening to him?
What's the face? I have approximately 45 years status.
See how you look picture perfect. And then all of a sudden within a minute everything would just collapse.
I have mental illness that's going on within me. So I try my best every day. That's all I can do.
We're increasing the quality of life for our community and for our clients. There's no doubt.
Be proud of yourself, be proud of you.
They're just people. They want to do everything that everybody else wants to do. They want to be happy. They want to have dreams. So now we into a totally different system.
So I'm going to toss to Judge Amero here, who was, I would say, insistent on letting people, having people see this video. And Judge, why don't you talk about why that was so important to you?
Well, sure. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
What I really wanted people to see was the problem. These accountability courts are fantastic. I was involved as a drug court judge for the better part of 10 years. I was also involved as a mental health court judge during a good portion of that time. And I will tell you that drug courts work, mental health courts work, that personal commitment of a team to help these people reintegrate back into society, deal with the underlying addiction, deal with the co-occurring disorders, this works. And what you see is you see a reduction in recidivism, you see saving taxpayers money, and you also see us doing a lot of good. And the stories of graduates have been well told from accountability court to accountability court in every part of the state. And frankly, Governor Deal and Justice Michael Boggs deserve a lot of the credit for rolling that out and supporting those efforts. They have been extraordinary. But there's work to be done. And I wanted to show you the conditions that some of these folks find themselves in the local jails. I recall a day when I was a mental health court judge, and there was a person who had severe persistent mental illness, who suffered from schizophrenia, and he was a veteran, and he was somebody who wouldn't show up to meetings, wouldn't do the little bit of homework that was assigned, wouldn't do the drug testing. And my staff was very unhappy with this. They wanted to sanction this person. And I said, well, you know, tell me about his illness, how it affects him. And what we learned is that this is a person that cannot do this program. They cannot follow the rules. They can't be where they're supposed to be. They can't work. They can't do it. Severe and persistent mental illness is all-consuming for people like Justin. And to ask more of them, to make them comply with the rules of an accountability court, and sanction them for it, is inhumane. And what I learned by dealing with this man, who's a lot like Justin, is that we have a category of people with severe persistent mental illness that can't really be helped by accountability courts, who should never be criminalized in the first place, who should have been connected to treatment from the beginning of the 911 call. Surely we have a public health system that will allow for us to do that, right? Surely we have worked out the systems necessary to make that happen. Well, that's not true. Everybody up here on this commission is working to try to solve this problem, and others. But I'm going to give you one last 30-second story if time permits. About 2 months ago, I had a person in my courtroom, 53 years of age, severe persistent mental illness. I think it was schizoaffective disorder. He and his 83-year-old mother are at home. They're on the couch. It's Sunday afternoon. He's not taking his medication. He's self-medicating with alcohol. What happens? He decompensates. He starts to see snakes coming in through the walls. He sees them coming after him. He sees them coming after his mother. What does he do? He stands, he screams. He punches at the air. He punches holes in the wall. And his mother, 83-year-old, walks up there, frail. She walks up to him and tries to calm him down. He's completely lost in his psychosis. And what does he do? He knocks her to the ground. She becomes frightened. She realizes she can't control the situation. She calls 911, thinking that the police will come and the police will help. Well, what happens? All she wants is him to be calm, to be connected to treatment, and to come home. What happens instead is he fights with the police officer, he damages the police vehicle, he ends up in the local jail. Somebody sets a $5,000 bond that he can't make. 60 days later, he shows up at arraignment. Just before that arraignment calendar, somebody gives me an order, says, Judge, sign this order that requires that he get an evaluation because we're not sure that he's competent to stand trial. You really need to do this because of what we have seen. Look at this case. And I said, all right, we can do that. And so then we start to look at the forensic system. What happens next? First of all, it took 2 months to get to arraignment. What happened next is it takes 103 days to get the psychological evaluation completed to see whether or not this person has is competent to stand trial. So the counselor, or whoever it is who conducts the evaluation, says he's not competent presently, but he can be restored. And of course, we go through a restoration process. The restoration process then begins by a wait time of 10 months in the local jail before the person is referred to the state mental health hospital, where it takes up to 9 months to restore them. This person, who was charged with criminal damage to property in the second degree, this person, who was charged with felony obstruction, who might have gotten probation had he been competent enough to enter a plea, ends up on a 22-month journey before he's sent back to the court for his case to begin. This is unacceptable. We have to do better, and we're focused on doing better. And I can tell you with all of my heart that the folks here, Kevin Tanner, Brian Strickland, Mary Margaret Oliver, everyone on this Behavioral Health Reform Innovation Commission is committed to making sure that on the forensic side, which is the side I'm most concerned about because I'm the judge and this is the court, that we impact this population. These people are most vulnerable. We make sure that they are better served by these processes. Thank you.
Thanks, Judge. So I think we have your attention now on this matter. Thank you, Judge. Carey, I'm going to go to you. The governor called you out, of course, so you go first. But obviously, you were on the Criminal Justice Reform Council and were part of getting this done. So for this group, summarize, you know, kind of where we are and the progress we've made.
Yeah, sure. Kevin, I had the great fortune that when I joined Governor Deal's office, you know, the Criminal Justice Reform Council was a well-greased machine. I was, in fact, I'll take one side note to say, I was actually sworn into the bar in a session of Judge Deal, Jason Deal's Superior Court in Hall County, in a session of his accountability court. And it's something I will never forget. And it's something that really motivated me personally to continue carrying out the good work for my boss, for Governor Deal. And, you know, over 8 years of legislation, or 7 years of legislation, we might have had less than a dozen no votes on our criminal justice reform legislation. I don't say that to say that everybody was necessarily getting along, because it was a big shift to move forward. But our mandate, our focus, was within the criminal justice system. And of course, the pervasiveness of mental health, the lack of mental health resources extends well beyond that. And you know, we started making some pushes in that direction. We encouraged fostering at accountability courts, encouraged through grant funding for to support local sheriff's offices who were transporting those individuals to back and forth through the accountability courts for free up until that point. But it's not something that our Criminal Justice Reform Council was necessarily equipped to go to the level of the Mental Health Commission now. And it's actually, I was looking back through our reports before I came here today. And in the final report of the Criminal Justice Reform Council, we've left a note of some things that we didn't get to. One of which was more focus on the intersection of mental illness and the criminal justice system, the prison system, and then more generally, with our society and in our state. And I cannot say that we as the Criminal Justice Reform Council take credit for the work that some folks that Commissioner Tanner doing and others, but it was an acknowledgement that we still have a long way to go on the mental health process. But you know, the progress that we made and that frankly, you know, continues now is something that I can't say I necessarily expected to happen, but I certainly am proud of it, and I certainly am glad to see it continuing to move forward too.
So, Kevin, what about you? What do you see in terms of progress from where you sit, where the river meets the road, I think?
Yeah, well, thank you very much. And, you know, I had the great honor of serving in the General Assembly for four terms, and much of that time under Governor Deal's leadership, being able to be there and take votes on criminal justice reform, and having come from a background for many years of working in and running a law enforcement agency and seeing the revolving door system, I was thankful to be part of that great work. And the state owes Governor Deal and his team a great debt of gratitude for where we are today, so I appreciate him and his leadership. But like Carey said, one of the things that the Criminal Justice Reform Council recognized was there needed to be a deeper dive into the mental health space. In 2018, I approached Speaker David Ralston and said, Mr. Speaker, we need to take on this mental health issue in a way that's not been tackled before. And as a result of that, I was able to introduce some legislation with his support and others on this panel today that served in the General Assembly to create the Behavioral Health Reform and Innovation Commission. That was created, and we've been at work now going on 4 years, and I truly believe there's never been a group of people, and I'm not in this category, but the others on the group that are as smart or as well dedicated or as well versed in a topic than the group that I get to work with. We have split our work up into subcommittees. We're looking at access, we're looking at workforce, we're looking at courts and corrections, and we're looking at adolescents, because just like Carey said and just like Judge Amero said, the mental health conversation is much broader than just criminal justice. And we've got to be able to provide off-ramps and services for individuals before they ever get to the criminal justice system. House Bill 1013, which was introduced by Speaker David Ralston last year, was a result of the work of the commission. It was a major step forward. House Bill 520 this year that Representative Oliver and Representative Todd Jones are carrying in the House, another major step in that work. I will also just mention to you that Judge Amero talking about 911, one of the things nationally that we're working on is 988 that was stood up on July 1st of this past year. That is an emergency number for people in mental health crisis. Our department operates that. When you call, they have the ability to triage the person and their needs. We dispatch mobile crisis to those people anywhere in the state. Those mobile crisis providers are clinicians. They go to the location, they work with the family, they work with the individual to identify what services they need. If they need to be in a crisis center, they're able to bring them to that crisis center and have them committed there for a short period of time to get stabilized. But we've got to continue to build out our system. We're working hard on that. I know we'll talk more about it. But I'm excited about House Bill 520. I'm excited about what it will do for our forensic code. It tasked our commission to create a task force to completely rewrite the forensic code here in Georgia, to look at community-based restoration programs for misdemeanors and nonviolent felonies, to look at jail-based restoration. We just stood up our first jail-based pilot program in Cobb County. We have 6 people there now. We anticipate growing that to 20. And I just met with Governor Dale's son, who is one, in my opinion, one of the finest judges in our state, Jason Dale and Judge Goslin, and we're getting ready to start a pilot program there around the forensic space. So there is a lot of movement in the right direction in this area, and I appreciate being able to work with all the members of this panel to move this conversation forward.
All right, thanks, Kevin. We'll be coming back to you on a few other things. But Representative Oliver, he mentioned legislation, so this is your chance. Why don't you talk about the bill and the choices you've made or are pushing as next steps to keep us going and what practical outcomes you're hoping for?
First, let me thank Governor Deal for his kind comments. He was my first juvenile court judge when I was a 24-year-old lawyer. And of course, I knew nothing like most 24-year-old lawyers know nothing. And he and many other of the members of the bar in Hall County and all over North Georgia helped me learn how to be a professional. And then to work with him in the political environment, it's really been a lovely long friendship. So thank you for being here today. One of the benefits of being in politics is occasionally, not every day, but occasionally, you have a real opportunity to help people. And David Ralston spoke about his commitment to mental illness reform in a way that to me sounded very sincere, very authentic, and reflected him as a representative and as a person who also had worked in the court system for decades. Every time he talked about his leadership for mental health reform, he said he just was tired of not being able to help people. He always quoted his wife, Cherie, who told him, you can't just think about elections, you have to help people every once in a while. I thought she deserved a lot of credit for that. He said that it was absolutely a bipartisan bill, that mental illness affected rich and poor, black and white, all over the state, rural and urban. And then he would tell stories of constituents coming to him with terrible tragedies in their families, and he sincerely responded with not being able to help them enough and wanting to use the power that he had in the Speaker's office to do so. And he did so, and he was committed to it, and we ended up passing, with Brian Strickland's help in the Senate and David Ralston's help in the House, an 80-plus page bill that passed unanimously with no votes. It committed also over $200 million of new money. And we took the first step in 2022 to make some significant reforms in the way crisis intervention programs operated on the ground, particularly the co-responder programs that I think is a big improvement in how police officers go out on 911 calls. On the expanded program, AOT, outpatient patient programs, outpatient treatment programs that will be supervised and monitored. We worked on the workforce issues. And coming into 2023, it is clear to me that workforce is the most significant and dramatic and difficult issue affecting not only the you business people that might own a McDonald's or working in any kind of commercial institution. Workforce is a significant problem for all social services delivered by government. We have close to over 25% vacancy rate in our treatment service providers in Department of Behavioral Development, Kevin Tanner's programs. You can't successfully operate when you've got significant vacancies, and we have them all over the state. So in moving towards 520 in 2023, we're focusing on workforce development, expanding the loan education program. We committed $10 million last year for students to get student loans going into the mental health fields. We're expanding it this year to folks who are sitting in chairs but delivering services but may still have a student loan. We're creating a new alternative disciplinary process for folks that dropped out of the license board system, either because of a behavioral problem or because COVID took them out for whatever reason, and allowing a different way to come back into licensure. That is a way that has been very successful for doctors. We are expanding it to nurses and other licensed mental health professionals. We think that the way we can get people back to work is not only salaries, which is clearly something we're doing also. $5,000 increase last year for every state employee, $2,000 increase this year for every state employee. We also have to remove the barriers to all these licensing boards who simply aren't modern enough. The other thing we're doing in this bill relates to, again, the evaluation of how many beds do we have in Georgia for the severely mentally ill, and how do we know how those beds are being used? There are 600 intensive psychiatric beds approximately for children in Georgia, and I believe over half of them are occupied by children from other states. If I'm right about that, which I think I'm right about that, that's a significant issue that we need to address. We may have enough beds if we just started paying for the services that we're delivering in other states. We're doing, with Kevin Tanner's leadership, a lot of analysis of the two populations that to me are the most visible examples, I don't want to say failure, but the most visible examples of gaps in our mental health system. You can walk out that street and there'll be homeless, mentally ill people you will encounter in the first block. Yesterday in the Capitol, there was a lady who was obviously agitated riding the elevator up and down all day long, as far as I kept seeing her. Nobody was bothering her. I don't think she was bothering anybody else, but she was a behavioral issue that was clearly affecting how she was communicating with herself in her loud talking in the Capitol elevator. Across the street from the Capitol, there are large numbers of people. Our failure to deal with the homeless, mentally ill veteran or the homeless, mentally ill family leader is significant and visible in our communities. And there's a group of folks, and Judge Amero is referring to this, who go from jail to ER to crisis unit and back to the street. That's a circle. And it is not improving the quality of their life. If somebody is going to die on the street, then we in the General Assembly have to be concerned about how you prevent that. And we are going to do more on that issue. I think that the general public, Republican and Democrat, because of the tragedies in their own family, or wherever they may go to church or synagogue, or wherever they may go to work, they are seeing the impact of mentally ill people in their immediate vicinity, immediate company of their family. The tragedies of families of suicide, particularly young people, more evident in rural areas of Georgia than urban, is significantly weighing on the hearts and minds, and I think, of the members of the Georgia General Assembly. And we have a good bill, another good bill, 51 pages. We'll have a hearing on Monday. And I encourage you to tune in on the Wide World Web and watch our hearing and tell your House member and your senator what you think about the reforms that may be needed in Georgia.
Senator Strickland, Senator or Representative Oliver mentioned families and a bill, I think, coming your way. What are you saying to Georgians and what are you hearing from Georgians about this?
Well, first off, I knew I'd be speaking last on this, and I just want to say thank you for not going to the bar yet. I don't think anybody left in the room. It's an honor to get to be on this panel with these great people who all have different roles in solving these complex issues in our state. Honored to get to serve on the stage with Governor Deal. One of my favorite memories on the campaign trail, there's not a lot of favorite memories on the campaign trail, but I remember an event in McDonough with the governor. We were in a restaurant, local restaurant, and there was a cook in the back, a young guy, who wanted to say something to him. They brought him out and he stood and thanked him for changing his life because of criminal justice reform. Because of reforms that Governor Deal passed, helped pass and led on, he had a job. He was back with his family. And that's just one person I saw. And so I know why he has so much emotion when he talks about this, because he was actually able to change thousands of lives around our state and really change the direction of our state forever, what he did. And of course, Carey being part of that as well with the team. And I think it's appropriate, I'm not sure whose idea this was, I'll give you credit, Kevin.
No.
The idea of connecting Governor Deal criminal justice reform with mental health reform. Politically, there was one thing that you might not have called, but I called when Governor Deal was talking. He made a comment that I don't think the General Assembly is undoing what we did. There's a growing narrative and a question being asked to a lot of us, including to me, is whether or not we're now going backwards on criminal justice reform. We appreciate that you're looking at mental health reform, but by being tougher on certain crimes, are you now going backwards? And I want to tell you that obviously the two are connected, but the General Assembly is still also directly working on criminal justice reform by itself as well. We can't replicate what Governor Deal did. It's his legacy. It's the legacy of his office. The Reform Council, what they did, we can't even try to replicate that. That's going to be his legacy. I'll give you one example of how we're trying to continue what he did, not just through mental health reform, but directly with criminal justice reform. 2 years ago, nobody's probably even heard of this, but there was a nonpartisan group of House and Senate members that came together as a working group with some other industry folks that said, what is the next step? The Reform Council is done. Luckily, mental health reform is starting to roll with the commission now. What's the next step when it comes to just criminal justice reform? We don't want this to stop. We don't want this to go backwards. And through that working group that has been led by two groups that you wouldn't normally put together, you start seeing a theme here with Democrats and Republicans. You have the Georgia Justice Project, which people would deem to be a more liberal-leaning group. Not fair, but that's what they would say. And the Faith and Freedom Coalition, maybe they are a conservative group, a more socially conservative group. Those two groups together, with a lot of people falling behind them, started this group, or joined this group of bipartisan legislators, and said that criminal justice reform is not just the right thing to do because it saves the state money, but it's the right thing to do. It's the right thing to do because it impacts lives. And because of that, just two examples of bills. 2 years ago, we passed probation reform bill that dealt with early termination of probation that helped, at the time, about 50,000 people in our state that were nonviolent offenders, had followed all the rules, everything they're supposed to do, actually get off probation. And this year we're working on a bill, you teed it up perfectly for me, dealing with workforce and our licensing process in our state and looking at the barriers that we've created with occupational licensing, where you have different standards for every single board based on what's on your record, whether or not you can actually get a license to work in our state. The number one issue I think you'll hear in the theme of all this is workforce. We can pass all the laws we want to pass, but if we don't have the workforce here to work in these areas and to take these jobs, then the services won't be there. And with the bill that I'm going to present on Monday, committee on my side, Senate Bill 157, I think it's the number, I didn't learn the number. We're looking at a whole 81-page bill, rewrite of our licensing process when it comes to criminal records to make sure that boards have to show and have the burden of showing that they're going to not deny a license because something on the record that that offense they committed is directly connected to the occupation they want to work in and makes them a danger in an occupation. And something very simple that we're going to do too is we require boards to actually put on a website what disqualifies you from working in certain industries and give you a chance to get what I call pre-clearance. I've got this on my record. Before I go to school, before I invest money in all this and try to work in this area, will I be denied a license because it's on my record? Because at the end of the day, what we all know is that I hear lots of statistics. I'm no expert on this. One thing I do know, though, is that if you have a job and you have access to health care, you're less likely to be in our prisons. You're less likely to be a threat to society. You're more likely to stop what may be a cycle of generational crime in your family where people end up in jail or hospitals in your family through generations and actually start another generation of being a productive member of society. But it's all about access to health care, access to mental health care is part of that, of course. But one of the things we focused on last year with parity with House Bill 1013, but access to a job where you can make a living as well. So that's the biggest thing I want to leave this panel with, is that we've identified lots of problems that we have, and we talked about what we're working on. But just know that we're still committed to what Governor Deal led on for years as well directly.
I actually have some questions for the panel, but I'm allowing for the possibility that some of you may have questions, so I'll keep my eyes open. If someone steps to a microphone, you have your chance. But Kevin, for you, I mean, there's a lot of hope and optimism here on this end of the stage. From where you sit, what are the most urgent needs? If you could just pick what you would really like to have fixed or what you're seeing out there, what is it?
It's a good question, and I have the answer for that, and because I talk about it everywhere I go every single day. So many times in policy, we talk about symptoms of problems, and we don't get to the real core issues. But I will tell you, if we do not, and Senator Strickland mentioned this, but if we do not address the workforce crisis that we have in the provider space, we're not going to be able to fix this system. people ask me, why do you have someone stuck in an emergency room that has developmental disability or a mental health issue? That's not where they belong. Why do you have someone in a jail too long waiting on a forensic bed at a hospital? Well, I can tell you it's because of the workforce crisis. We're putting in place a system that will improve the state of behavioral health in this state and put us as a leader in the country, but we have to address our workforce crisis. And that's easy to say, that's a big problem, so how do we do it? Well, I'll tell you that a couple of things. Number one, our provider rates that we pay, and Judge Amero hit on, or I think Representative Oliver talked about out of state people taking up our bed space. Our provider rates are low because they have not been looked at in so many years. On the IDD space, it's been 15 years since we've done a complete provider rate study. The average pay in that field for someone as a direct care professional is $10 an hour. So we just completed a rate study. It'll be finalized early spring. It's going to result in a 40% increase in our provider rates. DCH is currently underway with a rate study for the behavioral health side. It's going to result in a significant rate increase. I met with two providers today, major providers and multi-state providers, that told me if these rate studies are approved and funded, they're looking to make a substantial investment in the state of Georgia by building additional resources. If we don't address workforce, nothing else matters.
Judge, let me come back to you. We're trying, the discussion's about trying to, I think, decriminalize mental health problems. I mean, how much of that have we actually accomplished, and from where you sit, how much of it, are we still criminalizing?
I think the short answer is that this is the topic that we're working on right now. We have a long way to go. One of the things that we need to know right away is how many people in our local jails suffer from severe persistent mental illness. We don't know that. How many people in our local jail who suffer from severe persistent mental illness who are involved in criminal justice have also had contact with the services that are provided by DBHDD, the wraparound services? We don't know that. Which of these interventions on the adult mental health side work to stem the flow of the severely mentally ill from adult mental health into local jails, which don't work? We don't know. Data collection is not very sexy, but data collection is something that we've committed to in this bill, and I think that we need to know the answers so we can come up with some sound policy and we can begin to better address this question of criminalization of the mental ill.
Kevin, you might want to say something on that data collection point, because it strikes me about the process with the Criminal Justice Reform Council. I saw Adam Gelden here earlier, and his group, I would pew charitable trust at the time, was very helpful for us on the technical assistance part of how we know we want to address it, but how do we address it? I mean, there were, I think, frankly, until probably the final year of the term, we were walking out of the governor's office, we could not firmly put a number on the number of misdemeanor probationers in the state. You just couldn't do it. There were, because each county was counting it differently. You'd have some that counted it by people, some that counted it by counts. And so you can't really get at how to fix it until you know what the data says about, you know, the direction to fix it. And so that data collection point, I mean, as simple as it may seem, and people may roll their eyes, they see a bill that said, all right, we're gonna start tracking this. That's actually very, very meaningful.
And what is the definition of severe persistent mental illness? And is it the same? Do I use it in my local jail in the same way that you use it in your local jail? Is the department using it differently than the state prison system? We all need to get on the same page. I think one of the measures in the bill is focused on making sure that we have a uniform definition of severe persistent mental illness.
Thank you. Look, we have about 5 minutes left, so I'm going to give each of you 1 minute to make a point that you want to leave folks with or that you haven't been able to make. I'm going to start working with Revolver because I know she can be concise and do something in 1 minute. So take it away. We'll go right down the table.
Thank you for your interest in mental health reform in Georgia. We need your participation because I am fairly confident in saying every one of your family, close family, or extended family has some issue you're struggling with. The Georgia General Assembly is committed to making changes that impact the quality of life that families suffering mental illness face. And as unsexy as it is, data collection and analysis of where our $34 billion is going and how it's helping and not helping people is very much at the core of what I want to spend my time doing in the next year.
There's been comments about how bills pass unanimously. Carey, I said about 20, 30 people over all those years voted against those bills. Those bills are very difficult to pass. People are scared to vote no when it comes to the floor. They try to kill the bill behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. You have fights about details. 1013 about died several times in the Senate the last couple days, but it passed unanimously once it gets there. I say that to say we need your help, as Representative Oliver said, not just with your legislators, but you all have expertise in different ways. Don't be shy about sharing that with the citizen legislature. We need everybody on the same page, giving us your advice, making sure we do this stuff right.
We need to ask people with severe and persistent mental illness what they think and what they believe that we can be doing better. This has been dubbed the year of the peer, and we're going to intently listen to what they have to say to hopefully inform our policy initiatives.
Yeah, I'll take a minute to say, I will butcher it, but say a line that Judge Mara had when we were discussing this before we got here is that our police officers and sheriff's officers are not doctors, they're not nurses. They are being put into a position of responding as if they are a 24-hour mental health, you know, ER. And the work that these folks are doing, it continues to keep Georgia moving in the right direction, both in the criminal justice space and in the mental health space separately and where they both intersect.
You know, I often get asked why in the world would I want to take this issue on, because it's not an easy one to tackle. It's really not. There's a lot of other things I can spend my time doing, but I hopefully you don't mind me saying this, but Governor Dill called me a few weeks ago, and just to show you his heart and why I think this work's important. But he called me about an individual who'd applied for a job, but was having some difficulty within our department because of his criminal record. And he was, he spent many, many years in prison. But he was applying, and he had really turned his life around, started his own business, and was helping other folks. But he wanted to be a forensic peer with our department. And there were some roadblocks from our policies. So we took a look at it, and I talked to the director of our adult mental health side who was gonna hire this individual, and I said, is this the person you want? And she said, absolutely. So we adjusted our policy. He's now working in our prison system with other people who suffer, because recovery is real in this space. People can and do live recovery each and every day. There's no other work, in my opinion, more important that we can do for the next generation of Georgians than to get this right. This is people business, it's people work, and it's work worth doing, and I'm excited to continue to have these conversations and improve the system, so thank you.
Thank you for that final word. So Richard Griffiths has a few things to say. We're gonna stay in place till he's done, but how about a hand for this guy?
A terrific panel and a terrific keynote. And what a fantastic day. A few items before we head to the reception. I want to again thank our sponsors. In particular, again, I want to thank the bar who make this space available to us, who give us so much support through the year. And again, for that fabulous parking. When you have the opportunity on your way out, please thank them. I also want to thank the Planning Committee, members that have worked so hard to pull this event together. And there's one name at the top of the list there I want to thank. It's written in small type, so I've blown it up just a little bit. Peter Canfield is our planning committee chair. The first conference was in 1989. We skipped a couple of years, one very early, and then one after 9/11. But guiding this effort through the last 30 years, 30 conferences, has been Peter Canfield. It is his labor of love, corralling plenty of type A lawyers, judges, and journalists, getting them on a committee, getting them to work together towards a program that educates, informs, and challenges. We owe Peter a huge debt of gratitude. Please step up here for a moment.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go get a drink.
Thank you again for your help on that podcast.
Well, it wasn't very much help.
It was help to us.